My dear friends, welcome to the continuation of the Italian road trip, complete with junk store tour. Well, antiques to be more precise in this one. Yes, it's been a while. I know I've been working on other videos, so I'm finally back to this. And here we go. We are now entering a medieval village. Beautiful. This is not far from that grand abandoned hotel that we talked about or featured in the last episode. It really is quite beautiful up here, and what makes it even more special is no cars are allowed. You have to park below and climb up the mountain side. It's not very steep. Obviously, if you're in a wheelchair, I think it's impossible. I don't know whether they have wheelchair access. They may do to the left there. Maybe there's some sort of lift. I'm not sure. I really can't answer that. But obviously in those days it wasn't built for wheelchairs. They didn't really take that into consideration. Unfortunately. It's a beautiful, beautiful old church. I didn't go in. It's not for everybody. You know, if you ever visit there, you can check it out. I will put a link in the description with the relevant details of this village, where it's located, etc. You'll probably be able to find images of the church, the interior, etc. And it was a glorious day. The weather was perfect. Not too hot, just lovely. I should have come up here very early in the morning. It would have been really gorgeous when no one is around. You have that feeling of communication with God. Just showing you inside the hallway here. Lots of medals or medallions, for goodness knows what. And with a view, a vista of the landscape below. Yes. Yes, when you park down below, unfortunately you get harassed by beggars. And they get quite aggressive. That's a downside to it. They were even intimidating old people. That's a shame. I wish the Italian government would do something about that. Yeah, so there we have this. This is all sort of hewn out of rock. And people have built their homes in these tunnels here. They're absolutely, it's incredible. Imagine the amount of work. And of course you have that sort of little holy grotto there. Very religious people they are, or were. Yes. Yeah, so if you park below, do lock your car. And, I don't know, these beggars, they should do something about it. I say it again. Isn't that wonderful? Yes. I don't mind people begging, but when they start getting aggressive about it, I'm very angry if you don't give them anything. And I think, why should I give you something? Why? Go and get a job. And by the way, this beggar was very, very able-bodied. Very muscle-bound, so there was no need for him to be up there harassing elderly people. And this has been the museum of the village, but unfortunately it was closed, and it looked like it had been closed for a long time, not just on that day. Sort of a vernacular railway. Didn't get on it, don't know where it's going. Probably down to the village where we've just come from. Ah, maybe that is the invalid wheelchair access through that funicular railway. This is a little hotel where we stayed some years back. I also featured the video. It's also in this village below that sort of, that plateau up there. And yeah, we stayed there. You'll see it. It was about 4 years ago I featured it when I did the abandoned hotel exploration. Sleepy little village. Not much going on there. Sort of the feeling of going back in time. Tea rooms long gone. Now it's sort of cheap accommodation. Long-term cheap accommodation. The days of grandeur are long vanished. Yeah, so it's not that far over the border from Switzerland. So if you ever, this is the beauty of Europe. You can really, hop over borders, and you're not really far from anything. and you can sort of find these fantastic places. I heartily recommend it after this damn coronavirus quarantine BS is over. Once you can get it around. Because in Italy at the moment, everyone has to wear masks, even outside. And thank goodness when we were there, we didn't have to do that. I would have hit the turbo charge in my car and scooted back over the border. No doubt it's coming here soon too. Oh dear. I don't know. Takes all the fun out of it. Imagine walking around in the heat all day with a damn mask on. Not my cup of tea, I can tell you. I'm having a bit of a whinge. Yeah. Yes. Well, look at that orb. Look at that orb flying around. What is that, a moth? He's following me. Something jumping around on the screen there. Can you see that? Isn't that weird? Couldn't have been an insect. It couldn't have been that in keeping up with me like that. Very strange. Ah, this is the cemetery. Maybe the orb was leading me there. This is just below the plateau that where the church was. Tiny little ornate cemetery. Obviously shows there hasn't been that many inhabitants in that village over the centuries. They all fit in here. A few family vaults. That's quite modern, doesn't it? Villa chic. Looks sort of like a ticket office, doesn't it? Oh, excuse me. No offense to the family intended. But it did look rather out of place, didn't it? Like where you sort of get your, you know, tickets to a pop concert or something like that. Yeah. Very quiet here, very relaxing. They love to have photos with their family members with the grave. A lot of Italians have that. Is it popular in your part of the world? Do you have photos on the graves? Let me know. I think this one's got a mirror. I don't know what that's all about. Sort of check your lipstick while you're paying your respects. Anyway, let us whoosh away from the cemetery and try and find some glorious junk. So we spotted this place as we were driving by and drove back. It looks very interesting. It looks quite upmarket, doesn't it? Not your sort of thrift store kind of items. It's all sort of, yeah, antiques, real antiques. So we have to rephrase it. It's the antique junk store. No, it's an antique store. It's an antique store, a proper one. There's some really nice items. Really nice items. We were not sure whether it would be open during this corona epidemic, but this elderly man came forward from his workshop at the rear and let us in. The door was closed. And he couldn't speak any English or German, and we don't speak Italian, unfortunately, so he brought his very obliging son to help us with any information that we required. Yes, he was telling me that actually the old man, I'd asked the old man, basically he had a smattering of English. I was asking him, is it doing, you know, well at all? And he said, yes, very well. Oh, perfectly fine. Everything's there. Lots of selling. And then the son confided with me afterwards and said that he hasn't actually sold anything for many years. The prices are really high, crazily high, I found. And he said he only makes a living from restoring antiques. Well, shall we head in? Let us do so. Join me, my dear viewers. You see that? There's old servants' bells. It would sort of ring and the number would light up or move, depending on the room where the person was ringing the bell. Yes, lots of sort of architectural stuff too, which I do like. I love to see, you know, interior fittings. Isn't that lovely, that lamp? Isn't that gorgeous? I do like that. I dare not ask the price. I think I would have a heart attack. I did ask the price of an old pastel picture, painting, drawing from about the 1930s, and I got a hell of a shock. You'll see it soon. Not the shock, but the painting, or pastel. Old pram. But he had some lovely stuff, I must say. And it's a shame because he's not getting the prices that he would have in the 70s and 80s. People are just not buying, especially at this time with this corona situation. People are hanging on to their pennies and dollars. They're not giving them out. They're only, you know, sort of holding on to them for necessary items and things. It's a shame. But at least the old guy can still hang on there. He owns the premises. Look at that. Look at some sort of viewing mechanism. What are they? Sort of like a stereoscope type of thing? I should have asked him. I forgot. I don't really like people following me around anyway. And the son kept a polite distance, which was very decent of him. Potty chair. Yeah, he had a really, really good range. I think you'll agree. Yeah, I think if you were renting the premises, you wouldn't be able to keep it open. The fact that he owns it, that enables him to just keep doing what he loves, his passion, which is great. And I think it's great that he's still getting work for restoration. Yes, the glory days of antiques are in limbo at the moment. Will it ever return? I think so, at some time. But when there's a recession or a world panic, things like this are luxury items and they just don't sell. Yeah, it's a great place. It's got a lot of space. It doesn't really have any pedestrian traffic, so it's only cars. So there must be people who know him, basically, who know to come to him for good restoration, I guess. Look at that lovely painting, that sort of pastoral painting there of the Swiss Alps. I like that. Some things did catch my eye in this shop, I must say. But out of my price range. Old console table in relic condition. Yes. Stuff everywhere to catch the eye. Beautiful items. Look at that plate and that magnet. See, there's the workshop back there, through there. I would love this building myself. I really would. To put my stuff in. Isn't that fabulous? I love it. I guess you couldn't afford to be, you know, in a main city and have this size with an antique shop. Yes, I would like this building, I must say. He got a lot of stuff though, hasn't he? He's got more than me. I like that chair. I do like that chair. I come back to that. That is something special. That really did catch my eye, that wicker chair. Very much so. Doesn't look comfortable, but it's fantastic. Yeah, this is a collection of a lifetime collection. Yeah, this chair, I love it. Look at it. It's just so unusual. It needs total restoration. I really did like that. Sort of, you know, turn of the century grandeur, beautiful. So this is where I saw this pastel, which I really liked, and asked the price. I got a bit of a shock, but he did assure me. It's coming up now. It's this one here. I love it. He said it's by a well-known artist and they wanted €2,500, which was a bit pricey for me. I don't know. I'm sure it is a well-known name or quite well-known, but you just don't get the prices at the moment. Yeah, I do like it, but not that much. You know what I mean? Would you pay that much for it? Would you pay that much? Let me know. Maybe you would. It was beautiful. Well, we're coming to the end of the video. I hope you've enjoyed tagging along with us. It was a pleasure having you here, and stay tuned for what is coming for Halloween. For Halloween, we have this video. It's going to be about Peter Curtin, the German serial killer from the 1920s. Quite horrific. If you're squeamish, do not watch it. It's the special Halloween presentation, and that will be coming in time for Halloween. So that'll be something to look forward to. I know not all of you like, well, the ones who don't like watching these explorations won't be watching this video. So they won't know it's coming, will they? For those of you who are considering jumping over to my Patreon site, haven't yet decided, I can let you know what the last few uploads were. And the first one is this. My dear friends, join me as we whirl back through the decades, this time to 1970. A middle-aged couple attended a cocktail party in Chicago, and after they left the hotel, disappeared without a trace. Let us investigate everything that led up to the incident and the efforts afterwards to find them. Now showing on Patreon. I'll have a Manhattan, what's yours? My dear friends, join me on Patreon for a new historical feature, and in this episode, we take a fresh look at the mysterious death of Mary Jo Kopechne on the island of Chappaquiddick. Why did it take Edward Kennedy so long to report the accident to the authorities? Was he even driving the car at the time? Evidence suggests that Mary Jo survived for some hours in the submerged car because of an air pocket. Why did Edward Kennedy, until his dying day, never really revealed what happened that night on Chappaquiddick? Join me on Patreon, my friends, to watch the full episode. Check out the link below. Check out the different membership levels starting at $3. It's a bargain, I tell you. Hope to see you there. And just uploaded today, the facts behind the fiction of The Phantom of the Opera. The real-life incidents that inspired Gaston Leroux when he wrote his novel, The Phantom of the Opera. Join me, my friends, and thank you for joining me today on my travels, and hope to see you again next time with your bags packed. Take care, God bless, and bye-bye.